Hello viewers, our Critics Take is back with another episode. The new phase of centralized free COVID-19 vaccination has begun from June 21st. And in a historic feat, nearly 81 lakh dosage were provided on the first day of the new phase of COVID-19 vaccination. However, having a suitable and effective vaccine is just as crucial as having the free vaccines. Which vaccine against COVID-19 is the most effective? For the past 2.5 months, this has been the most frequently asked question about COVID-19. To be honest, finding a correct and legitimate response to this has been pretty difficult. In this episode, we will attempt to solve this complex and challenging question. During the last year, this channel updated you with various challenges of COVID-19 vaccines. Those who missed those videos may watch them again. I am giving the links in the description box. Let me request my viewers to watch this video till the end. We will use the prestigious medical journal The Lancet to discuss the efficacy of several COVID-19 vaccines available in the market. Before we go into the specifics of vaccine efficacy, let's have a quick look at the current immunization status of the developed countries. Perhaps that will help us to understand the issue in a better way. To begin, let's have a look at the US vaccine rollout. Right now, around 44% of the Americans have received both dosage of vaccine. Please note that the US has entered into the 6th month of its COVID-19 vaccine rollout. If you consider to add on the population, those who have received only one dose or the first dose, the total figure stands at just 50% in the US. On 29th April, the CNN reported that the vaccine manufacturing companies changed their shipment sizes as coronavirus vaccine demands declined. Lori Trimmel Freeman, CEO of County and City Health Officials, told CNN that many of their health departments, especially those in rural America, are providing feedback that they need smaller dosage vials or their vaccines will be wasted. A CNN opinion poll states that at least 25% Americans say that they will not get the shot of vaccine. Because of the widespread public opposition, state and municipal officials in the United States of America have asked vaccine manufacturers to reduce the size of vaccine vials. As a result, Pfizer announced that it would offer lower package sizes. The shipment size, which was containing more than 1100 dosage, now is reduced to a pack containing just 450 dosage. Free beer and marijuana are being offered by the US government in exchange for COVID-19 vaccine. Younger adults will be provided with free beer and marijuana after their first or second immunization. Across the United States, health authorities and a number of private organizations are implementing such efforts, which are aimed mostly at younger generation. The viewers of this channel must decide whether or not it is justified to give out free beer and marijuana to young people in order to advertise the COVID-19 vaccine. In any case, while Indians have been queuing since midnight and fighting one another over a COVID jab, the United States of America is attempting to entice its countrymen to do the same. Anyway, now let's have a look at the situation of cumulative vaccine uptake in the countries of European Union and European Economic Area. As of June 17th, just few days back, less than 30% of adults in European countries have been fully vaccinated against COVID-19. Let's take a look at some of the countries' immunization data. Bulgaria and Finland, for example, had completed immunization for roughly 10% of their population. As of May 30th, 2021, around 18% in Sweden, 20% in Austria, Norway and France, between 21 to 23% in Netherlands, Germany, Belgium, Portugal, Italy and Spain have completed their vaccination. Almost all European countries are in a similar situation. Malta is the only European country with a vaccination rate of around 49%. And Hungary is the next with roughly around 47% of its vaccination completed. But what are the likely causes of Europe's immunization programs' such dismal results? Viewers will notice that vaccine dose availability was never an issue. Now, let's take a look at the chart which shows the immunization status of some of the Europe's most advanced countries. And the extreme left, it is the name of the country, then vaccinated per 100%, and then availability of vaccine dosage per 100%. Just take the example of Bulgaria. Their vaccine, you see the extreme right, vaccine dosage available per 100 population is 55. Means 55% people should have been vaccinated with the available vaccine dosage. But only 9.7%, less than 10% have been vaccinated. Finland, for example, more than 75% vaccine dosage were available, only around 11% vaccinated. Sweden, more than 79%, nearly 80% vaccines were available, only 18% got vaccinated. Same way in Austria, Norway. Then if we go for France, Netherlands, Germany, Belgium, in each and every country, vaccines availability were much more, but vaccinated very less. Coming to Portugal, next, Italy, Spain, Hungary. Take the example of Hungary. Per 100 population, vaccine dosage were available 166 dosage. Means more than the population, but vaccinated only 44.7%. It is quite clear that despite substantial vaccine supply, the vaccine push in some of the Europe's most sophisticated countries has yet to achieve sufficient success. When we look at Australia and Japan, the scenario for vaccine proponents is much less favorable. As of 17 June, only approximately 3% of Australians had a full vaccination, while about 21% had received only one dose. Just around 6% people in Japan had been fully vaccinated, while roughly 16% had just received one dose. The poor performance of many affluent countries when it comes to COVID-19 vaccination raises concerns about the vaccine's efficacy. Viewers should be aware that currently no coronavirus vaccine is fully approved by the FDA. All the vaccines were given emergency use authorization only, since the candidate vaccines could not overcome their potential dangers. Hence, none of them have received FDA clearance. That's likely the most important factor for individuals' lack of interest in COVID-19 vaccination in developed countries. With this background in mind, now we will use Lancet to discuss the efficacy of COVID-19 vaccines. The study that we will discuss here was published in Lancet Microbe on April 10th of this year. The study suggested that at present, approximately 96 vaccines against COVID-19 are at various stages of clinical development, and we have the interim results of 4 vaccines which were published in scientific journals. These vaccines are the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, the Moderna vaccine, the AstraZeneca-Oxford vaccine, and the Gamaleya, that is Russian Sputnik vaccine. Excerpts of these results have been widely communicated and debated through press release and media, more than the scientific community, and thus sometimes is in misleading ways. Attention has focused on vaccine efficacy by comparing the reduction of the number of symptomatic cases. However, in these discussions, understanding the efficacy and effectiveness of vaccines in totality is less straightforward. Vaccine efficacy is generally reported as a relative risk reduction, RRR. When you see a headline in the media about vaccine efficacy like 95% for Pfizer-BioNTech, 94% for the Moderna, 90% for the Sputnik, 67% for Johnson & Johnson, 67% for the AstraZeneca-Oxford vaccines, the reports are usually referring to relative risk reduction. Now, what is relative risk reduction? Relative risk reduction is how much risk is reduced in an experimental group compared to a control group. For example, we have 2 groups of people. One group has been vaccinated, which is termed as experimental group, and the other group has not been vaccinated and is termed as the control group. Let's say in the control group, those who were not vaccinated, 20% people died of COVID-19. And in the experimental group, 5% people died of COVID-19. 20% is called as control group event rate, CER, and 5% is called as experimental group event rate, EER. The formula to derive the relative risk reduction is CER minus EER divided by CER. So if we go by mathematics, 0.20 minus 0.5 divided by 0.5, that is 15% divided by 5%, 0.3, that is 30%. In other words, the death rate in the vaccinated group is 30% less. Although relative risk reduction provides some information about risk, but it does not say anything about the actual odds of what is happening. Relative risk reduction, or RRR, considers only participants, which varies between populations and over time. Therefore, the media headlines about vaccines' efficacy are just half-truths. This leaves us with the unanswered question as to whether a vaccine with a given efficacy in the study population will have the same efficacy in another population with different levels of background risk of COVID-19. But this is an important question because transmission intensity varies between countries. Now we are seeing Delta Plus, all these things. And as because the transmission intensity varies between countries, they are affected by factors such as public health interventions and virus variants. To derive an estimate of vaccine effectiveness, the absolute risk reduction, or ARR, has to be calculated. Absolute risk reduction, which is also called as risk difference, is the absolute difference between the control group and the experimental group. While the relative risk reduction considers only the participants of the trial, the absolute risk reduction considers the whole population in terms of difference between attack rates with and without vaccine. Subtracting the experimental event rate, ER, from the control event rate, that is CER, yields the absolute risk reduction. If we take the previous example of relative risk reduction, in that case, what would be the absolute risk reduction? The absolute risk reduction will be CER minus ER, that is 20% minus 5%, 0.15, that is 15%. When computing the absolute risk reduction, the relative risk reduction of 30% was reduced to only 15%. According to the study that we are referring to, Lancet microbe study, absolute risk reductions are often overlooked because they have a significantly smaller effect size than relative risk reduction. And to understand this, let's have a look at this chart. This we have derived from the Lancet study. Name of the study, name of the vaccine, then relative risk reduction, or RRR, and then absolute risk reduction, or ARR. See, for example, AstraZeneca Oxford, the efficacy rate is 67%. That means relative risk reduction is 67%, but absolute risk reduction is just 1.3%. Moderna, 94% efficacy claims, but its efficacy in terms of absolute risk reduction is just 1.2%. Johnson & Johnson vaccine, 67% efficacy is claimed, but absolute risk reduction is only 1.2%, that is its actual efficacy. Gamaleya, that is Sputnik vaccine, claimed is 90% efficacy, but actual efficacy is less than 1%. 0.93%. And finally, Pfizer BioNTech vaccine, which claimed 95% of its efficacy, actually the efficacy is much less than 1%, it is 0.84%. So the efficacy of the vaccines that are claimed are not true. When communicating about vaccine efficacy, the use of only relative risk reductions and omitting absolute risk reductions, the vaccine manufacturers produced biased data which affected the interpretation of vaccine efficacy. Comparisons should be based on the combined evidence that puts vaccine trial results in context and not just looking at one summary measure. Ranking the vaccines by their reported efficacies based only on the relative risk reduction is unfair. Moreover, these studies measured the efficacy and effectiveness of vaccines based on the prevention of mild to moderate COVID-19 infections. They were not designed to conclude on prevention of hospitalization, severe disease, or death, or on prevention of infection and transmission potential. Unfortunately, the vaccines that are currently available on the market do not meet any of the critical requirements. Therefore, we will have to wait for the right vaccine to arrive to combat COVID-19. I hope you have enjoyed watching this video. Please share and like this video, as well as subscribe to our Critics Tech channel on YouTube. Thank you for watching.